So I would like to formally welcome you all. Good mid-afternoon. Thank you once again for coming to the mid-afternoon masterclass. Well, I say once again, you might have been here before or this might be your first time, but either or, welcome. So this is the mid-afternoon masterclass during this year's Science Festival brought to you by the University of Melbourne as part of National Science Week. To start, I'd like to acknowledge the Kulin Nations as sovereign custodians of the lands on which the University of Melbourne campus is situated, and where the mid-afternoon masterclass team and many of you, our wonderful audience, are zooming in from today, of the Wurundjeri, the Boonwurrung, Yorta Yorta and Jarjarawurrung peoples. We extend our respects to ancestors and elders past, present and emerging, and to all First Nations people, including those who may be in the audience today. Welcome. So I'm Julia, I will be your host today, and I have been here every day this week, and I'll be here once again tomorrow at 3 p.m. This has been an event that's been very successful all week, as we've brought you brilliant scientists from across the university to discuss a range of fascinating topics. And today, it's all about urban greening. And our guest today is Dr. Claire Farrell. So welcome, Claire. So Claire is a senior lecturer in green infrastructure. As a plant scientist, her focus is on plant selection for survival and high performance landscapes. Claire has a PhD in plant ecology, and for the past 9 years, much of her research has focused on developing green roofs for Australian conditions. So welcome, Claire. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Thanks very much, Julia.
No worries. So in a moment, Claire will discuss a very exciting new approach to urban greening using Australian shrublands as a template. She'll discuss what inspired them and how they are transforming streetscapes and parks around Australia. So it's really interesting stuff to come. That's it for my introduction. So without further ado, Claire, I will get you to get started. Good luck. And I'll be back here for some Q&A very soon.
Thanks, Julia. And I'll share my screen and get started. So thank you so much, everyone, for joining us this afternoon to talk about woody meadows. It's really wonderful to be here and to really be able to talk about woody meadows with you, which, as we've described in the title, is a new approach to urban greening, using Australian shrublands as a template. So why would we be interested in using shrublands as a template? Well, when we think about low maintenance landscapes that are rolled out across cities at the moment, you can see the images there on the right. Now, they're all incredibly dull. They're not very interesting. And whilst they are low maintenance, they're not very diverse. Now, diversity is not just about aesthetics, it's also about function. If we rely on one or two species in our plantings, we can create a system where we don't have any resilience or any capacity to adjust to changing conditions, whether that's with a changing climate or just changing conditions of land use around it. So there needs to be a better way to have landscapes which don't cost a lot, don't need a lot of water or fertilizer, but look a lot better. Now, internationally, people have been looking at this problem with different approaches. In temperate parts of the world, like the UK, and this is an example from the London Olympics, they've been using meadow or naturalistic plantings of annuals and perennial flowering plants. And they sow these with seeds, they let them grow, and then they flower throughout spring and into autumn. At the end of flowering, the plants are able to set seed, and then they mow these so they're flat on the ground again, and they stay that way throughout winter till the next spring, when those seeds will germinate and create another meadow. Now, that approach is fantastic, but there are a couple of reasons why this won't work universally in Australia. One is that we're in our landscapes all year round, and I think never has that been truer than this year, where we're out in our landscapes walking around in this time when, other than being in our houses, the public landscapes are really key to our well-being. So we need landscapes that do things all year. The other reason is that these plants can't cope with our hot and dry summers in Australia. We would have to put irrigation in them, and we would have to apply fertilizer because they're not the native soils that these plants grow in. And so they would become high maintenance and high input landscapes. So we wanted to look at how we could adjust the meadow concept in Australia using our own plants to create these naturalistic landscapes that could be low maintenance, but have beauty and lots of flowers. And so shrubs were a natural pick for this. So this is an example of a native shrubland or heathland growing in Western Australia. And you can see here, this is a picture from winter, so there's lots of acacia flowering, but it's already a beautiful landscape, yet this is completely in its natural setting. And these plants are good for low input plantings because they grow on sands with low fertility, and they can cope with the rainfall or the lack of it that we have. Now these systems, they regenerate through fire. And this means that you get renewal of the plants, so the plants don't get old and straggly. Instead, when they're burnt, they're able to either re-sprout from underground tissues or roots, or they can reseed from seeds that are either in the soil seed bank or in cones that are on the burnt plants like the Banksia that you can see in the bottom there. And in reality, there's a gradient of an ability to re-sprout after fire. So some plants do it really well and others don't do it as well. And it's this capacity to regrow after fire disturbance that we're using in the woody meadow concept. And so for the woody meadow, we obviously can't go around burning large areas in cities. And so we're thinking about how we can use coppicing to mimic that fire response, and how can we use this to create shrubs that are dense with lots of leaves and lots of flowers. Now coppicing is a hard pruning technique. It's used in horticulture to grow cut flowers, and it's used in forestry to grow timber after harvesting the main tree. And you can see here in the picture on the left, it's basically cutting the whole plant off at about 10 to 20 centimetres above the ground and letting it regrow. And this example on the other side is of Birung Ma, and you can see that that's actually a eucalypt that they continually cut so that it keeps its juvenile leaves and grows more like a ground cover. And coppicing is a way to get lots of flowers. And so this is a lavender farm in Provence, and you can see here that they use a big mower to essentially cut the lavender shrubs so they get through all the woody material and they can harvest the flowers, but also regenerate that plant to grow lots of flowers next time. And so what is a woody meadow? So a woody meadow is a diverse planting of Australian shrubs. And obviously we've come up with the name woody meadow. Any plant scientists in the room will know that meadow is a term that refers to herbaceous plants. So by putting in shrubs, we're calling it a woody meadow. It's low input, so we water only for the first summer. And it's all about reducing weeding. And we do this in two ways. The coppicing means that we get very dense canopies that exclude weeds from germinating from underneath them due to light limitations. And we also plant them close together so that we get canopy closure very quickly after planting. And we plant in an inorganic mulch, which you can see here in this picture. So it's basically a rock-like material, which means it's got not many nutrients in it for weeds to germinate and enjoy the conditions. And it also doesn't have any contaminants. So green waste can often bring weeds with it. So by using these things, we reduce weeds. And we coppice them every 2 to 3 years at that 10 to 20 centimetres above the soil surface. And the woody meadow concept began as a pilot project which ran from 2015 to 2018. And this was a collaboration with the University of Sheffield, so in England, where they've been doing these wildflower meadows like the Olympic Games one that I showed you earlier. And we were funded by the City of Melbourne and the Trawalla Foundation to do trial plots at Cranbourne Botanic Gardens that you can see here, and plantings in the city like this. So Cranbourne Botanic Gardens were part of our partnership, as was an expert panel of native plant experts, so horticulturalists and landscape architects, who helped us with our plant selection process. And so the woody meadow at Birung Ma, which is the example I'm going to talk to you today, was designed to have three layers. And so we have this base layer, which are plants like Dampiera elata, which are less than a meter tall, with a few plants that are between the 1 and 2 meter mark, like the Calathamnus quadrivatus or one-sided bottle brush. And then a taller layer where there are only a few of them of these eucalyptus caesia and the Elaeogyna hughlii here you can see with the purple flowers. And the base layer is the dominant layer in the community. So you can see there in the first list, there are a lot more plants in that list than in the bump and emergent layers in the other columns. And for those of you that are familiar with these plants, you'll see there's lots of things like bottle brushes, eucalypts, malalucas, and plants like that. And really the woody meadow is about a cycle of coppicing and growth. So after planting, it obviously grew and looked amazing, as you can see in that top photo. We then cut it back and it's grown back from that point to the other side there that was taken in April this year. That'll then be left for 2 years before we go through the cycle of coppicing again. And so how did we do? So in the pilot project, within the first year after coppicing, we had 93% after the coppicing event. And so that's across all plants that were planted in the initial planting, which was several thousand plants. And following the first summer where these plants were drought stressed, they weren't irrigated, and we had a very hot summer where the February had basically no rainfall at all, we still had an 80% survival. Now that in a public landscape is a really high survival rate. And the one thing that I would point out as well is that this site being so exposed to public events like the tennis and the food festivals and things like that, we got a lot of vandalism. So even within that 20% that died, a lot of that was due to plant damage or people ripping out plants and not death due to the circumstances of growing in the dry conditions. And we achieved the canopy closure in the first year to reduce weeds. So we created this system that was low maintenance with low weeds. And importantly, we had flowers all year round, which is good for aesthetics, but also for potential biodiversity. So we've been able to show that woody meadows as plantings have high aesthetic appeal and that they can recover well from coppicing. But widespread uptake across Melbourne and across Australia is going to depend on how they can cope with different conditions and different levels of drought stress. So can they cope in very harsh soils against hot roads and things like that? Or do they need to be protected in some way? So obviously drought stress resistance is going to be key. And so one of the ways that we wanted to test is whether we could predict plants' drought tolerance by where they come from. So in other words, could we use the climate of origin of these plants to predict which ones would be drought tolerant and favour them for woody meadows in hot and dry conditions? And you can see here these atroplexes and blue bushes growing in central Australia, where it is extremely arid. We wanted to see whether that made them more drought tolerant than a shrub that may grow in temperate parts of Victoria or even in rainforests in Queensland. Our other question was that with coppicing, are we actually making these plants potentially more vulnerable to drought stress? So you can imagine that after chopping back a mature plant that has grown under stressful conditions, that the new shoots might be more vulnerable to drought stress if it occurs. They're not going to have the same level of toughness of tissues. And so perhaps if they get too hot and there's no water, they might just wilt and die. And so we did a common garden experiment to evaluate their drought stress tolerance. Now, a common garden experiment is when you plant all plants of different species together in the one bed, so they all experience the same conditions. And you can see here those plots at Burnley where we planted these species. Now, to select the plants that went into this trial, we initially identified over 1200 species that could be used in a woody meadow, so they could recover and resprout from coppicing, from literature reviews of fire literature, but also from some of the horticulture literature on coppicing. This list was then shortlisted to 287 species based on the experience of our experts. So which of these plants would struggle in Melbourne due to the soil type? Which are the ones we wouldn't be able to get because no one is growing them in nurseries? And which species might be the winners because they do so well already in our tough landscapes? And so this meant that we selected 48 species for the experiment. Now you can see the plots over time here. And so it's a sort of, I guess, a 1.5 year process from planting through to that establishment period where they're watered for their first summer. Coppiced, so pruned to 10 to 20 centimetres above the soil surface. And you can see we did that by hand in the experiment and not with a giant mower in this case. Then you can see the growth after that coppicing event at 6 months, so in spring, and then what they looked like a year after that coppicing event. And so to answer our first question, where we wanted to know whether the shrubs from those more arid climates were more drought tolerant, we used an index called a turgor loss point, and you can see that on the x-axis up here. Now, turgor loss point is a measure of how resistant to drought stress a plant tissue is, so a leaf or a leaf and a stem and a small branch. And so the more negative that number is, the more drought tolerant that plant part or tissue is. And so we compared that to the aridity index of where these plants naturally occurred. And we used data from the Atlas of Living Australia to compare the herbarium records of those locations with their climate data. Now, a lower number means it's more arid, so more hot and dry, and a higher number means it's less arid, so more wet and mesic. And you can see here that in terms of drought tolerance, and aridity, there's no real relationship at all. But what we do see is that we expand a wide range of aridity in our experiment. And so in answering our question, we can say that no, shrubs from more arid climates are not more drought tolerant. In terms of finding out whether newly coppiced material is less drought tolerant than older coppiced material, you can see here on this graph where we have the species on the y-axis, and again we have turgor loss point on the x-axis. So again, a more negative number means more drought tolerant, and a lower number means less drought tolerant. And we can see that for the plants that were newly coppiced, so the measurements in spring are in the blue, and the ones that are after summer are in the orange. And you can see there that pretty much for all species, the newly coppiced material is much less drought tolerant or drought resistant on a tissue level than those that are older. And so in terms of practicalities, what does that mean for woody meadows? So while we're always disappointed that we don't find a relationship that we hypothesize, that, you know, we didn't find that plants from hot and dry climates are more drought tolerant, from a plant selection perspective, it's actually really exciting. This frees us up immensely. It means that we can start thinking about shrubs, no matter where they come from, as long as they can reshoot after being coppiced, they should work in woody meadows in hot and dry conditions. We also know that coppicing works from the woody meadow plantings and the high survival after coppicing. But what this experiment has told us is that we need to think about when we do it. If we do it in spring and then we have a very dry spring like we had last year, or we have a very severe summer drought, those plants may die because they can't cope with the drought stress as if they were older. And so we might think then that we need to coppice in autumn so that those plants have longer to grow before summer stress. And all of this work is really the first step in designing them for greater than the City of Melbourne plantings. And look, this is one type of woody meadow as well. And the step now is to think about what these look like in different situations. And so we're doing this by expanding the woody meadow network. We've been very fortunate to be awarded an Australian Research Council linkage grant to research woody meadows across Melbourne. And we're doing this with the help of 5 councils, Greening the Pipeline, which is a massive greening project in the West, Vic Roads and City West Water. We've also been collaborating with the level crossing removal project to put woody meadows along the new elevated railways and also along railway tracks. And for a plant scientist and a passionate horticulturalist, this is exciting. If you've ever had conversations with trying to get plants in these spaces, it's really hard. There's so much opposition to putting plants next to infrastructure because of maintenance, because of height concerns with power and other infrastructure. So to have them on board wanting to put these diverse, innovative plantings at large scales across the project is really exciting. And so with this network, we're going to look at how the timing and frequency of coppicing affects growth and survival. So do the plants run out of steam? Is there a point when they can no longer come back and grow again after coppicing? We also want to look at how robust and resilient they are. Can we put them anywhere and will they thrive? Or do they need to be irrigated in certain situations? And how do we modify the design of them? So do we always use three layers, or sometimes do we keep out the trees so that we can put them against railway sidings and road signs? If you would like to know more about the Woody Meadow project, we do have a website where there's a lot of information, including the two guidelines that have come from the City of Melbourne Woody Meadow pilot project and also the level crossing removal guidelines. There's lots of plant lists in those as well, if you would like to know more specifics about how to do this, as well as guidance on site preparation and maintenance. We also have lots of news of what we're up to in the Woody Meadow project. And if you would like to build your own Woody Meadow, we encourage you to register it into the network so that we can find out what you do and learn from that as well. I'd just like to acknowledge the following people for the pilot project: the City of Melbourne and Trawalla Foundation for funding, the Royal Botanic Gardens in Cranbourne for their assistance with the measurements and sites, but also the expert panel of John and Warren, who contributed with Scott Watson from Vic Roads and Paul Thompson. In terms of the level crossing project, I would really like to point out Rebecca Hendy's support of this. She's been magnificent and really helped get that across the network. And I'd also like to thank my University of Melbourne and University of Sheffield collaborators on the project. Thank you very much. And you're more than welcome to contact me if you have any questions or if you would like to be involved in the Woody Meadow project. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Claire. That's fantastic. It's a fantastic project you're working on. And I think as a very passionate Melbourne resident, it's fantastic to walk past the Woody Meadow myself, but to know that it's going to be expanding, particularly along train lines and places like that, where it's screaming out for this sort of thing. So, fascinating. So thank you so much. We're going to questions now. So everyone, if you've got anything to ask Claire, please put it in the chat and we'll try and get to as many questions as possible. If you're not sure what question to ask, have a look at the chat box and just like any questions that you'd love Claire to ask, and we'll get a good sense of what the audience might be after. So we've got quite an early question that came in where we might start, Claire. From Caroline. So in a garden setting, could one coppice partially each year, say one third cut on a 3-year cycle in order that you don't have a bare bed?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question because the idea with woody meadows is they're made for public landscapes where everything has to be done efficiently and effectively and cheaply. So the broad scale chop is kind of the model for that. In your own garden, I mean, pruning one third every year is okay. If you wanted to go harsher and get right down there to say that 10 to 20 centimetres, I probably wouldn't do it any more frequently than every 3 years, just so you don't exhaust the plant, unless you know it's a really strong resprouter. But definitely, I think the mistake with native plants in the past is that being we've never pruned hard enough. And so this, I think, really shows the benefit of doing that.
Mm. Yeah, okay, fantastic. Great. Yes, so from Hillary, we've got, are you also monitoring the impact on insects and other wildlife in these garden settings?
No, we're not, Hilary. And I think it would be a great thing to do. Anecdotally, we know when we're in the woody meadow that it's covered in insects and birds and everything like that. And that's even within the city of Melbourne, where, you know, diversity is limited because of the built environment. The one thing that we've sort of focused on with the woody meadow at this stage is getting it to work. So it's all been about the plants and about site establishment and things like that. But these questions about biodiversity and how people react to them, especially after coppicing, are all key things that will be wonderful to embed in the project as we go forward.
Mm. Okay, fantastic. Now, onto, I guess, replicating the woody meadows. There's a question about doing it in different countries. So possibly this is someone from one of our international audience guests. When replicating the woody meadows in a different country, should native species be used or foreign species?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, isn't it? Yeah. I know that with the Olympic Games meadows, not all of those were English or European species. Some of them were South African even. So nativeness is not necessarily a key criteria for plant selection, but it can be a driver. I suppose for us, there's so many amazing Australian plants, like that list of 1,200 that could work, meant that we wanted to focus on that first. But look, I think the key thing here is the habitat template approach. So it's thinking about what template in your own country or in your own situation makes sense for a naturalistic landscape and replicating that process. And look, there will be risk sprouters in many parts of the world in different ecosystems, because it is triggered not only by fire, but also things like cyclones or tree falls in different ecosystems also trigger resprouting responses. So that's something you could find in other ecosystems as well.
Mm. Okay, fantastic. So it looks like we've got a couple of questions too of people that want to be starting things and need some recommendations as well. So Kay Jones, have you any tips for planting in colder areas? So Macedon Ranges is where they're probably from.
Yeah, so I guess my first response would be to go and look at what shrubs are working well that are in your neighbourhood or in council plantings. And our experience has been that even though we thought that only true resprouters would come back from coppicing, basically everything has some capacity to resprout, especially when they're young. So I don't think you need to focus too much on whether they're a resprouter. I think it's more to know that they're a good shrub and they're tough. I guess my best bets off the cuff would be acacias, callistemons, malalucas are all fabulous. And look, thryptomene saxicola, I think, is a plant that's been abused in public plantings, but when it's pruned like this, it's the most magnificent pink flowering thing. So I would definitely include that.
Mm, fantastic. And a bit more recommendations. So from Questacon National Programs, which is fantastic. Welcome, Questacon. If I wanted to create my own woody meadow on my balcony, what's the best way to start?
On your balcony? Okay. That's tough. that's really tough. Because I'm going to shoot pots and... yeah, that's tough because root limitations are a thing. So these all work better when they're in the ground because they'll have different root strategies to survive drought. But if you wanted to plant some of the dwarf Australian natives, like the native hibiscus, dwarf bottle brushes and things like that, you can prune them and keep them magnificent using this approach. But on a balcony, I'd also think about using native wildflowers as another planting to get lots of flowers and diversity. You'll have to replant it every couple of years. It won't be as permanent, but because it's a balcony and you can interact with it more, I would go down that approach as well.
Okay, fantastic. Going from lots of different areas now. So from Mitch, I think we're sort of maybe going back to some of the research that you've done with the woody meadows. So have you explored various substrate depths? So thinking in terms of roof garden settings or wide planters.
No, and that's a really good question. We did plant a mini woody meadow on the green roof at Burnley, because we could. And so that was in a 25 centimetre deep substrate planter. And for that, we just chose the smaller plants. So things like the bottle brushes and melaleucas and some of the ground covers like Gardenia arvata and things like that. So I guess it's thinking again, how big your plant is a good indication of how deep the roots are. So if you're going to be limited, thinking about those sort of things. The one thing we have found though is by using that scoria mulching layer as our mulch in the plantings in the city of Melbourne, is that even if the site was compacted underneath, the plant still grew really well. And so that leads me to think that as long as you have a top layer that plants can grow in, it can be shallower than we think otherwise.
Okay, all right. Well, that's good. I guess that's some good news there. Okay, now a question from Callum, which I think is fascinating. So is there any suggestion that woody meadows in the right areas, maybe hinterland behind riparian vegetation, could have any benefits to river systems, such as filtering out pollution and absorbing storm water runoff?
Yeah, great question. So so functioning like a buffer strip. Look, I think they would. In the level crossing removal project, there's actually some plant lists that we made for rain gardens or for areas where water could be directed off hard surfaces in a swale. And a lot of those species were melaleucas that have been used in bioretention or in sort of wetland edge plantings. And so I think you could use them in that circumstance and they could be effective. There'd certainly be a very beautiful planting on the edge of a property to use in that way. And I have been contacted by a number of people that want to use them as fence line planting. So I guess in a similar way, but maybe not thinking about the water removal capacity.
All right. So what else do we have? One from Anonymous. Anon. How large or small have the woody meadows been so far? How does that compare to the size of the ones planned?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. So the current ones were experimental sites. So they were made to fit a certain number of our plots so we could measure them. So the ones in Berrimah and Royal Park, they were 6 metres wide by 20 metres long. That was their size. We have also done a smaller one for the level crossings that was more about 12 square metres in size, so a lot smaller. And the ones that are planned in the network range between being small verge plantings that might be 10 metres long by 3 metres wide or 2 metres wide to massive 50 metre long plantings by, 10 metres. It just depends where they're going and for what reason. I don't think there's any threshold on size. I mean, you could have these lining entire freeways if you wanted to. But the key thing is I think you need at least 2 metres of width to read it as a meadow, because otherwise it's going to read like a line of a couple of plants.
Okay. Yes, that makes sense. And I guess how much resourcing you can actually go all the coppicing all the time. Just constantly coppicing.
Well, every 2 to 3 years. But then the other is that on roadsides that would be done with giant mower type things. And they already do that, to sort of chop down areas of bush next to roadsides or, where you have views next to big beaches and cliffs. So those kind of machinery.
Okay, so one from Caroline. I think we might have already had one from Caroline. So Caroline's back again. So actually, I will combine this one. We did have a question just about what coppicing was. So maybe if you could just reiterate exactly what coppicing is, just for those that might have missed that start bit. But then following on from that, if you coppice in autumn, do you lose the flowering event of that winter/spring?
Yeah, okay, so really good question. So coppicing again is chopping the whole plant off to 10 to 20 centimetres above the soil surface. So it's super harsh. Now the interesting thing about flowering is we would go back a month after coppicing and some of these plants would already have flowers on them. So it really depends on where the plants flower, whether they flower on terminal shoots or whether they flower on old wood. If they flower on old wood, like the calathamnus, you will miss the flowers the first season after coppicing. But things like the gardenias, any of the veronicas, and most of the plants actually would flower really quickly after coppicing. Pretty amazing. I didn't expect that.
Okay. Okay, so one from Sarah Mack, and I'm not sure I'm going to be able to pronounce the flower correctly, but I'll give it my best. So what do verticordias go in these type of meadows? Look like there were some in the early natural meadows you showed. Also, so two-part question. Also, do you also coppice the upper story to the same level as the understory? So let me know if you need me to repeat any of those parts of the question.
Excellent question. So thank you. So that's super well spotted in the Western Australian planting or native actually ecosystem, that they were verticordias in there with the acacias. And look, I think they'd be beautiful. They do resprout after fire. Verticordias are really tricky to get growing in Melbourne though. But it's possible that by using that rock-like mulch that a lot more Western Australian plants could do better, because that would give them a bit more drainage in winter. They particularly don't like that. But they grow them in the Cranbourne Botanic Gardens and they look magnificent there. So that is a group that I would like to work on more. In terms of coppicing different plants differently according to their height. So in the Woody Meadow planting, for the coppicing that was done last year, so that's the third coppicing, we cut everything at Birrung Ma, but at Royal Park we left the eucalypts to stay tall because they wanted to do that. So I think that this is something to think about, what's your design intent. So if you want to have trees left as an overstory all the time, then don't coppice them, just leave them. Alternatively, you could think creatively and coppice a mosaic. So just like when they do bushfire burning, how they don't backburn the whole lot, they do segments of it each year. You could do that with the coppicing as well if you didn't want everything to be bare all at once.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So a really good question now from Fiona Sutton. Looking at more developing more of these. So how do you recommend approaching our local council to adopt this concept for roadside vegetation? And can they be used under electricity easements?
Fantastic question, Fiona.
Good work, Fiona.
If they're one on the list, then you're already there. If they're a new one, then I'm happy to have a conversation.
Yeah.
And look, that's been an exciting thing about the network, is that even though the linkage partners are a certain subset that adopted it early, we're actually getting more people that want to join late, and we're accommodating them as well, so that we want these everywhere. So that's something. Easements. So the Green in the Pipeline project is actually the old sewage outflow pipe that ran from the centre of Melbourne out to Werribee. And it's a heritage sewer because of the way they designed all the open drains with the brickwork and that. It was an engineering marvel. And so that is an easement that we're not allowed to put anything tall in, and it has to have roots that don't go a certain depth. So we're restricted that way. So that's one type of easement where we're putting woody meadows. And we are doing under power lines in other plantings, especially with the level crossing removal, because a lot of those are on verges where there's street lighting and electrical poles as well. So yeah, definitely. You just leave out the emergent layer. So you keep the smaller layers, but you don't put the big tall trees.
Okay. Oh, there's just so much into all of this. It's just so fascinating. I had a question and now it's all jumped up. It's really amazing with the lighting of the questions. It's great. They just keep jumping around. Now there was something, here we are. So I had a question about, when you do chop them back. After coppicing, the woody meadow would look unattractive with no leaves or flowers. How do you address this issue? Some residents may question the attractiveness of such a landscaping method. So
Yeah, and that is something we were really concerned by.
Yeah.
But in actuality, it was only a month before we ended up with a lot of green foliage again from the last coppicing. I think the first ones are more drastic because the plants are smaller at that time. But as they get bigger, they've got more stems, so they take up more of an area anyway. So it's less of a concern, excuse me. But one way you can address this is by putting in more ground covers. So changing the ratio of those so that when you coppice, they effectively don't get coppiced because they're shorter anyway. And so they maintain your cover, and then you coppice the bigger shrubs. And so you still maintain flowers and greenery. The other way you could consider this is whether you sow annual wildflowers in it as well. So whether you do that and then it becomes a everlasting meadow after coppicing, and then when the shrubs grow back, they all shade them out and they're not there anymore.
Okay, all right. And an interesting one about the coppice material from Tom. Does the material need to be all removed, or can there be a benefit in leaving organic matter as mulch?
Yeah, look, that's something we haven't looked at yet. I think definitely for this to become more sustainable, it would be great to do that. How that might influence weeds would be something to think about though. But even if material that was taken away was mulched and then used elsewhere, it's a win. So I would think it's just thinking about where that goes. The other thing that happens in Europe, where they do coppicing of trees on roadsides, not as woody meadows, but they just do it to keep plants small, they then send that off to make biochar or use it for biogas for energy production. So I guess if you had this at scale, you could get those additional benefits out of it as well.
Yeah, long-term planning. I like this. Thinking big.
You gotta take over the world. You gotta do it properly.
Yeah. I know, it's so good. Another one from Judith. So I'm trying to use indigenous species on Mornington Peninsula. Any problems or limitations with this?
No, it's just the number of shrubs, and it depends on the ecosystems or the ecological vegetation classes that you want to use. So if it's just indigenous to that whole area, or if it's specific ecosystems that you want to have represented in terms of the plants, in the level crossing removal guidelines, there are some lists based on the EVCs. So if you know what number EVCs you're interested in of what you would like to represent, you can have a look through there, and there are shrubs that will tolerate coppicing and come back. But I'm happy to have you email me if you'd like to talk about that at any time.
Okay, fantastic. Okay, so we've probably got time for only one or two more questions. One from Fiona. Has there been any consideration of incorporating water-sensitive urban design to provide additional water sources and therefore diversify species selection?
Yeah, look, I would love to do this, Fiona, and we wrote specific guidelines for this in the LXRP project as well. I think directing water and using a problem to create beauty is an ideal solution. Every time we have a partner meeting, I say, have you got a swale? Have you got a rain garden? So I think we'll end up with a few to test out. Definitely worth pursuing.
Okay, fantastic. And so I guess just to round out, so Birrarung Mar is where we can all go and take a glimpse of the woody meadow right now, but where will be the next place that they might be popping up, and what is the very next stage that you'll be working on?
Yeah, the next stage is there's a few plantings in each of the councils that we're working with. And there are quite a few coming up with the level crossing removal project, especially on the Werribee line and the Moreland line that will be coming up. And all of these will be added to the Woody Meadow network on the website. So where it says register your Woody Meadow, they're all mapped and they're all described, so you can go and visit them. We have one at Sale Botanic Garden, which is on the website that you can go and visit. And we're also working with a couple of different groups to put them in Canberra, in a couple of parks with some friends groups. And there's a couple of plantings that have been put in Perth as well. So yeah, we're happy for it to expand, and we'd love to know where you put them if you decide to have one.
Fantastic. Oh, that sounds so great. So it's going all over Melbourne and it's going national, and there's some fantastic things in the works. So that sounds really exciting. There's a lot of great work that you're doing. So thank you so much, Claire. Thank you for all the work you're doing and for sharing all of that with us today and answering all those fantastic questions. So thank you so much. And thank you so much to the audience for asking so many great questions of Claire. But, and of course, go to the website to register to get more updates, because it sounds like it's all happening very fast and things will keep popping up everywhere, which is great.